Binary Jazz, joined by my heron-loving friend Allison, and swan aficionado Chris. We're here. We bring you tidings of comfort and joy, and fruit of the loom and whatnot.
Fruit of the loom.
You know, Fruit of the Loom wouldn't sound dirty if it wasn't already associated with underwear.
It wouldn't.
Because that, as a phrase in itself, is fairly innocuous. But
yeah.
In modern contemporary context does kind of sound a little dirty.
Well, and I feel like fruit is a weird metaphor. Right.
Yeah.
This is stuff you use to cover up your fruit.
Yeah. Like bananas and peaches and pomegranates. I mean, nobody calls any part of their body a pomegranate, but there are definitely associations with pomegranates and reproduction.
And an eggplant is not a fruit, as far as I can tell. Correct.
Right. Well, actually, okay. So I learned.
Maybe I learned something.
Yeah, I learned because. Because Aaron told me anything that grows that you pick off of a plant that grows externally is a fruit. It's a fruit of that plant.
Because isn't it technically a berry or something like that? Isn't it one of those weird ones where it's like a weird.
When we get into the weird obscure stuff, then I don't know. But what I understand is anything you pick off. And it's like, I think that's
so
basically like all the vegetables or most of the vegetables are actually fruit, but it makes sense because it is the fruit of the plant.
Yeah. Right. So, and one of the other definitions of fruit, right, is internal seeds, right?
Yep. And eggplants definitely have internal seeds.
Yeah. I was thinking though, like, how does that, like a banana obviously has internal seeds, but they're pretty much mush until the thing dries out, I would assume. So, like, we eat it, like, long before it actually turns into seeds that would grow? Is that the idea? How do bananas work?
That's a topic for another day. That's, I think, accurate for most fruit, though. Or, well.
Like, oranges have hard seeds internally before they dry out.
That's true. But, like.
If you bit into a banana and found a hard seed, how pissed would you be?
But bell peppers, I mean, not that their seeds are super hard, but. The idea is that the coating on the outside is the food for the plant that's going to grow out of the seeds in the middle.
Yeah, it's mind-boggling, isn't it?
I like it when you get you cut open a bell pepper and you get a little mini bell pepper inside.
Yeah. It always feels so lucky when that happens.
Right?
You really got your money's worth. You're like, I actually got more than one bell
pepper. Two peppers. It's a good thing mushrooms aren't fruit, though. That'd be kind of weird if you're plucking mushrooms off of trees, right? To de-seed the mushrooms.
De-seeding the mushrooms would be weird, yeah.
I think you would just do it like a pumpkin, though. You'd use like a spoon and just get in there and just... I'm assuming the seeds would be in the cap. I don't know. Maybe they wouldn't be. Maybe they'd be like properly like seeded in the stem somewhere.
Through the stem. Yeah.
Wow.
That would make slicing mushrooms.
I didn't design mushrooms.
That would make slicing mushrooms even more obnoxious if you had to like cut off parts of the stem.
Can you imagine that UX meeting about the mushroom user experience?
I'm sure that all plants of all kinds, each one individually, had a user experience meeting.
Obviously. I had a meeting yesterday where we discussed the impact of meetings. That wasn't the point of the meeting, but it was like a sequitur. Which would have been an awesome meeting, but it was not. It was just a developer's call, and we were talking about the impact of meetings on work. Not that we have a lot of meetings, but really, like, what's the ratio of impact? Like, I said 4 to 1, like 4 hours of code. But I sort of said it, I framed it negatively. Like, I will spend 4 hours writing code to avoid 1 hour of meetings. Which isn't really, I mean, it's kind of what I meant. Like at the root level of my being, it's exactly what I meant. But what I really meant was like that it needs to, if we're gonna have a 1 hour meeting, like it needs to accomplish saving 4 hours worth of work because of the net impact of the meeting on like change of course and whatnot.
I like the idea of user experience meetings for plants. I'm gonna go back to that and ignore your comment about coding.
That's fair.
Because I was thinking about jackfruit and the user experience meeting for jackfruit. I only know what jackfruit looks like because of a show that I recently watched an episode of that was recommended to me called Dirty Vegan, which is on BBC, and it's this former skateboarder extreme sports guy who became vegan then started like a YouTube show on like cooking vegan food and whatever. And so he's like this extreme, like really buff and gravelly voiced guy. And he's like totally excited about like jackfruit and beans and, you know, like proteins.
They're proteins.
And so he's at, I don't know, some restaurant, and they pull out an actual jackfruit, which is this ridiculously large, like watermelon sized thing full of spikes that you cut open, and then you have to scrape deep inside to get like the meat out of it. So yeah, the user experience of that, like, I mean, that the initial user experience of a jackfruit is like, oh my God, what the fuck is this? There's no way I'm going to touch that, which is probably intended. I'm assuming, like, you know, the jackfruit itself doesn't want people eating it. So.
What? So like, do you think jackfruit, starfruit, and dragonfruit were like all the same committee?
Yes. Yes, absolutely.
It seems like the inspiration
same was designer for sure.
Yeah. Same stick. Definitely. You can see the designer's hand at work in all of them. Yeah.
There's a certain brand aesthetic that's.
And that was totally like, that's totally like the designer that shows up with colored hair versus like the very corporate looking designer that shows up for like the apples or like citrus meetings in general, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
They will all be sour. They will have hard seeds. They will all be generally round and roughly this size.
Yeah.
Grapefruit can be bigger. Lemons can be smaller. Limes will make green. That's enough variety. Settle down. We're done.
Yeah. Yeah. No, the designer who did all the jackfruit and the dragonfruit and stuff is the one that has a mohawk that he sometimes spikes.
And comes kiwi was probably in there too, right? Like, let's make it hairy. Yeah,
that's fair. Yeah, yeah. Because kiwi is like, I'm going to take a lime and I'm going to cross it with a banana and I'm going to make it hairy and green and taste good.
Yeah, they were just riffing on limes.
Yeah, yeah. They're
like, we saw the corporate definition of limes.
That dude, corporate dude, he's a jerk. I'm going to make something that totally messes with his thing.
He said we needed palm fruit and we only have nine, so let's mix it up.
He took a lemon and made it green. Come on, how lazy is that?
But he made it hairy, so, you know.
It even tastes, well, no, I was thinking like just on the citrus side, like that committee. We got lemons. Let's make it
right.
Green and maybe taste a little greener. Okay. Do limes taste green to you? Because do you associate that flavor with green?
But would they taste green to you if you hadn't?
I don't associate the taste of limes with green.
Okay. I strongly do. Like if I have like tacos and they provide like lime to squeeze on top, like I take a bite and it tastes green.
I don't know what I would associate green with, but I think something more planty, like spinach or something.
Yeah, I don't think spinach is not green. I just think lime is like that flavor that makes me immediately associate green. I don't know.
I think when I first saw jackfruit, because I've only had them like, or prepared them from like canned jackfruit, basically. So when I first saw what it was like, in its essence, I was like, oh, and I was very grateful that I didn't have to.
Jackfruit's one that has propensity to like be stinky, right?
Is that jackfruit?
People can say it's
the other one. There's another fruit that people
Yeah.
talk about.
Anyway, that's like a prelude to how this podcast works. Topic comes up that we know nothing about.
Well, this actually works out really well because my topics are food-based.
Oh, good.
Yeah, so. Good.
I was actually ill yesterday and didn't eat much. I had some, like, bread and peanut butter.
Oh, good.
So I am, like, ravished today.
Oh, okay.
I was going to eat when we were done anyway, but now I'm really going to eat.
I was going to say, I was like, if talking about food is going to make this worse, then I'm really sorry.
You might have to have a hamburger or something.
Yeah, you're going to have to eat after this, I think, because we'll be discussing food, as is our wont. So it's less of an overarching topic and more of perhaps divisive, perhaps you're just going to agree on them, I don't know, food topics. So the first one I'm bringing to the table is...
Why do we have emoji, like, prepared for that? Sorry, say that again, and I want to interrupt this time.
Have a little list. Yeah. Where do you store your ketchup? In the fridge or in the pantry?
Fridge.
In the fridge after it's opened. When it's in the pantry, it's in the pantry before it's opened.
Oh, you agreed. I pulled a few different people, and it was very divisive. Some people don't store it in the fridge, which seems...
Doesn't it say on the bottle, refrigerate after opening?
Well, a lot of people aren't paying attention to directions.
I mean, okay, and maybe this will come up later, but like the thing that my grandparents used to put, I think, peanut butter in the fridge. And
that's
so I always...
That's my next one.
Yeah, I was wondering. And I was used to putting peanut butter in the fridge, and Aaron's like, why are you putting that in the fridge? It doesn't need to be refrigerated. I don't know. It's what you're supposed to do, isn't it?
I saw a gesture from Gary.
So I'm going to jump ahead to peanut. No, I'm not. I think ketchup, it's like simply a practical matter. Like the seal on ketchup is not, like, you have to put it in the fridge. Otherwise you get ants. And ants can't open refrigerators.
Yeah, but that applies to a lot of things.
It does. And I feel like a lot of them are going to come on this list. It's going to be interesting. But peanut butter, like, refrigeration, so like natural peanut butter, does that not change like the rate at which it separates? No.
Well, I mean, yes, it does. It does.
Slows it down, right?
Put it in the fridge, then it will not separate as much. But
that seems practical. But I also don't want like cold peanut butter.
Stir it up. Yeah.
Sandwich. Actually, I want cold peanut butter right now. I want everything right now.
You would take cold peanut butter in a heartbeat.
A bowl full of ketchup.
Just a spoon of it. No, I'm not a big ketchup eater. Use it in moderation. How about ketchup on eggs?
No. Well, I mean, I don't eat eggs anyway. I guess when I did eat eggs, maybe sometimes on omelets, although sometimes I put salsa on omelets.
Salsa makes sense to me, but ketchup. Allison, ketchup on eggs ever? Scrambled?
Sometimes it'll happen because they were next to the hash browns.
Yeah. So.
That's fair.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
But yeah, no ketchup.
But I'm usually a salsa or hot sauce person on.
Mm.
Or just let them be, because if they're good eggs.
I will say that the vegan omelet that I make is definitely something you put ketchup on.
Okay.
But that's like chickpea flour based, so it's not quite the same thing.
Yeah. Ooh, chickpea. Yeah. I love using chickpea flour for things, but you're right. It changes, it shifts the consistency.
Yeah, the recipe is basically chickpea flour, nutritional yeast, and like some spices like pepper and paprika and like a little bit of baking soda. And then you put it on the pan, you fry it up, and then you flip it, and then you put stuff in it.
That's delicious.
Yeah.
And now we're all having omelets.
I'm going to have like the weirdest lunch ever.
It's going to be... The tapas of all the different tastes. Okay, ketchup, peanut butter. We're just moving right through.
But Gary didn't answer peanut butter.
Oh, that's true.
Oh, not in the fridge. No, that stays in the pantry. Although with kids, it doesn't last very long anyway. So.
And that takes us to what is the better sandwich: peanut butter and honey, or peanut butter and jelly?
Oh.
Honey.
This is difficult, I know, because I'm bringing things to the table that Chris can't eat.
I eat honey.
Okay.
I don't believe that getting honey particularly harms the bees. Mm-hmm. Also, I have less empathy for insects.
Yeah, I mean, it, like, as long as it's not like Halliburton harvested honey, you're probably okay.
Right. I mean, we do get local honey, and we do get, like, yeah, but, so. Yeah.
Honey or jam? What's the?
Honey. Especially when, like, you get a little bit of crunch in there.
Like honeycomb?
Like the bread, like, yeah. Well, like the bread, like,
you yeah.
like,
no, I know.
The bread gets that, like, dry, the honey, like, the honey dries it out a little bit, and you get that.
The only thing I have, the thing I have against peanut butter and honey is that peanut butter and honey can be too sticky at times. And for that reason, I would probably lean towards peanut butter and jam.
There are some amazing jams in the world, but I feel like they stand on their own. I feel like I don't, and honey does as well, but I feel like peanut butter and honey is a better match than peanut butter and jam.
Wow. I feel like peanut butter and jam is the, like, perfectly complementary. And, like, there are some jams and preserves that are just not worth opening the jar.
Also fair.
Also but fair. Like, so, like, I'm thinking of, like, actually good jam, as opposed to, like, Smucker's strawberry grape. Or something, you know?
Concord,
like,
grape Smucker's.
Yeah. yeah. In which case I would definitely do peanut butter and honey, like any honey, any peanut butter, but
good. See, I feel like a good jam though. Like I could take that and just spread that on the bread, forget the yeah. peanut butter entirely. So that's how I would end up peanut butter and honey. Because if it's good jam, I'm not going to, I want to say ruin it because peanut butter can be amazing, but
I put, jam, but I like, do,
pedestal, pedestal food.
I put, I do almond butter and jam on like pancakes and waffles.
I'm having breakfast. It turns out after this, I was just kind of curious to see where this goes, but it's definitely gonna be breakfast.
Well, we haven't gotten out of the breakfast foods yet.
No, it's oh, there's like a hierarchy of needs.
I'm just gonna be going like a Chinese buffet and like having like everything.
Yep,
that's the goal. No, I think if yeah, let's see if it's a quality jam then. I don't know. I would lean towards peanut butter and honey unless the jam really piqued my interest.
The there's a raspberry preserve that Costco carries sometimes, but not all year round because of it's seasonal. And so whenever they have it, I have to like stock up because I know that in a couple months, randomly one day we're gonna walk in and they're not gonna have any of it, and I'm gonna go and be like, okay, what we have in the pantry is what we've got. So, like, that's going to have to last us 6 months.
Ration people.
Yeah. And I've never been able to hit the storage right. Like, every year it gets to a point where, like, okay, well, we've got enough of this in the pantry. We're probably fine. And then that's the day they cut it off. And then, like, I've only got 2 jars stocked up. I'm like, shit.
Like, I did not prepare for this.
I did not. Yeah. And their strawberry preserves is not nearly as much, and that's what they have for the next 6 months.
So if you get it at Costco, though, doesn't it come in like a 55-gallon drum?
No, it comes in something like this, like an extra large jar.
Yeah, 3.5 pounds of.
Jam. It's like when you get like a pickle jar. If you not like a huge pickle jar, but like a normal sized pickle jar, it's basically that size.
Gotcha.
But not ridiculously big. I mean, they do have pallets of the things.
Yeah. You know, like, so I buy them by the pallet.
I should. That's yeah. The thing that I need to learn is that if I buy it by a pallet, then I just store the pallet in the basement or something, and then we're good.
I wonder if you're the only person that covets it in this way. If you could, like, make a hefty profit off your pallet by selling it in the off season.
Well, listeners of Binary Jazz, if you too covet raspberry preserves from Costco, please let us know through the contact form on the site or on Twitter at Binary Jazz.
It is very rare. I wish this show had like super high production value on the video side, but right then I wanted like Chris's video to like take up the full screen and him to be like presenting like a glass jar of the jam with like a flashing like buy now or like easy installments infomercial.
Possible.
So, it's actually the first time I've desired that.
It won't be the last. It's just the first of many jam plugs.
Yeah, the rate we're going, like, every year and a half, I'll desire that. The jam plug infomercial.
Jam plug.
Sponsored by Raspberry Preserves.
Buy your jam plug today.
Okay, let's move on to... Okay, I think you both pronounce this word the same way, but let's see. P-E-C-A-N.
Pecan.
Wow, now that I thought about it, I don't know how I'd pronounce it, actually. Like, thinking about it, like, modified it. If I just read it, it would have been pecan.
Pecan, okay.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Pecan. Pecan.
Pecan.
I have no strong feelings on it, because I definitely hear it pronounced both ways.
Yeah, I probably pronounce it both ways. Parts. But, I mean, obviously my knee-jerk was pecan. And I think that is possibly influenced by the scene in When Harry Met Sally, where it turns out this is all improvised, where Billy Crystal is talking to Meg Ryan's character, and he's like, today we are going, I have decided that we are going to talk like this. Please, waiter, there is too much pepper on my paprikash. But I would be proud to partake of your pecan pie. So because he says pecan that way, and that's like obviously a very important movie in my childhood, because
apparently
I don't know why it influenced me in adulthood, but it did. So that's why I say pecan.
So I definitely hear around here too pronounced with like an emphasis in the first syllable. So pecan.
Pecan or pecan.
Although you have to like let it linger.
Yeah. I don't know. Now I have no idea.
For some people, it depends on if they're saying it before something or like
to pecan describe. Pie. Yeah, pecan.
That's not how I say it. I don't have that slant, that drawl, that like pecan pie.
That's how we hear you all the time. That's how you talk to us.
That's how I talk. Okay.
Yeah. I thought
I had a California accent. I don't know.
This whole time you were twanging and you had no idea.
It's Utah wearing off on
me. Joined as always by my friend Chris from Nashville.
All right. Moving on to kind of desserts, I guess. Edge piece or centerpiece for brownies?
Edge.
Edge.
Oh, wow. Total agreement.
Edge. Absolutely. Like the corner piece. Like get me all that crust.
Yeah. Might fight for it even.
Yeah. Yeah, in fact, like, there is a fight for it in this house, like, because my son likes the edge pieces, too. Like, so there's always, like, a battle over who's going to get the edge pieces.
The edges are just missing from the get-go. So.
They kind of do in my house. Yeah, there ends up being, like, a little island of brownie.
And, like, it Aaron will make them, and then, like, I'll walk in the room, and the corner piece is gone, and I'm like,
whoa. Got there first. Have you seen the pans where they have, like, the maze so that they all have an edge?
No.
Yeah.
That sounds amazing.
That might be a purchase that needs to happen.
Yeah, I think I need to do some research.
Oh, and it's such a simple, it's not even a contraption. It's just a maze pan where everybody gets an edge.
That sounds amazing.
Do you think you can accomplish the same just by taking aluminum foil and folding it? Because now you have a pan that you can only use for one thing.
You could use that for many things. You could have a maze-shaped cake. Why not?
Well, yeah, I was like, anything you prefer an edge to, you can, like, you could get, like, more crispy lasagna, although that would be a real challenge to...
Well, lasagna architecturally is a challenge anyway, so... True. I don't know that it'd be any more of a challenge in a maze-shaped pan.
I feel like the amount of foil you would go through would be perhaps cost prohibitive to your time.
Yeah, and I don't know that you'd get the same. I don't think
not my time. I mean, my time's not worth a lot.
I don't think you'd get the same result because the aluminum foil isn't thick enough.
Yeah.
So it's not going to warm up as much as the.
Oh, I was thinking like 17 layers is the right number.
Yeah, that would definitely be cost prohibitive.
Yeah. I don't know. I buy my aluminum foil from Costco, so I still have like 433 yards left.
That's true. Until you reach the very end, and there's never a signifier that you're almost out.
No, until you pull the last piece and it's like 2 inches long.
You've got nothing.
Come on, guys. Like a heads up would have been nice.
They
like,
should.
Like the rolls of receipt tape where it starts getting pink. Yeah.
The last foot of aluminum foil should be a different tone of metal instead of silver. to give you.
That's a better solution than what I had. I was thinking as I got to the bottom, like there should be like a flashing LED. Probably not.
A little more high technical, but that's all right. I was like, change it copper or change it gold or something. All right. Da-da-da. Let's see. Okay. Is white chocolate chocolate?
No, it's not. There's no cocoa beans or cacao beans. It's not. It's not chocolate.
It's got chocolate in the name. It's pretty.
But it's not actually chocolate. It's some dude just like, I'm going to make something that looks like chocolate. I'm going to sell it like chocolate. Call it chocolate. It's not chocolate.
So if someone was just like, hey, do you want some chocolate? And you were like, yes. And they handed you white chocolate. You would be disappointed.
Yeah.
I would be. I would be. I would be.
It's not chocolate.
Even though it's chocolate name, I'd be like, oh, okay.
I have some white
jokes
chocolate
on me, I guess.
It's a candy that they wanted to, like, I mean, I'm sure it was like a candy that wasn't selling, like, otherwise. So they're like, well, let's rebrand this and call it white chocolate, and then people will buy it.
So this goes back to, like, the food UX team of being like, we need to rebrand.
No. It did not get the name as a marketing thing. It got the name because someone was using this, right? And they were like, it works. It pretty much behaves just like chocolate. Because it's a rough approximation.
But it's not chocolate.
The
fundamental part of chocolate is the chocolate part.
I have like, no strong feelings about this.
The cacao tree that makes chocolate beans. Like, it's in the name.
I don't have strong feelings about it.
Well,
I do like the little Hershey's Kisses that are milk chocolate and white chocolate. I guess they're called Hugs, right?
Yeah.
They're adorable and taste good, so.
But then they're mixed with quote-unquote real chocolate.
Well, I don't eat white chocolate anyway because it's dairy, so.
Yeah.
So at some point, Hershey's did purchase cocoa beans in their history. Probably still riding that same bean.
That same bean. Oh, that's hilarious. Okay.
When we make our chocolate, we wave a bean near it.
But what I'm hearing is that white chocolate is the lesser of
winning. Oh, to be sure.
And Where does versus milk chocolate versus dark chocolate? I prefer like dark chocolate all the way. I'm like 100% cocoa.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would agree. Even when I was eating or drinking dairy, I would generally prefer dark chocolate to milk chocolate, partially because of how most milk chocolate is prepared. Like, you can get really, really good, like, artisan dark chocolate, and there's not a lot of the equivalent for milk chocolate. Milk chocolate ends up being, like, the crap. There are occasionally, like, there have been a couple, like, small batch milk chocolates that I've had when I was working in specialty at the Whole Foods that were really, really, really good. But I would still say dark chocolate all the way.
Mm-hmm. All right.
But like not just like any dark chocolate either. Like it like good dark chocolate.
It goes back to like similar to jams where you're like, no, the quality stuff. Like,
yeah, because there's a lot of crappy dark chocolate too. Like it's not just like dark chocolate all the way all the time. It's like, no, like the single origin dark chocolate that like is like around 70%.
Mm-hmm. Oh, so good. So swing back. I should have included this in our sandwich section. Bad organization, Allison. Diagonal cutting or straight across cutting?
When I'm feeling fancy, I will cut diagonally.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
When it's like more of an industrial type, like I need to eat type meal, you know, then it's just right across. And
yeah. I mean, we don't make sandwiches a whole lot because you're hitting on all the like the challenging things. I mean, I guess food is challenging in general when you're gluten-free and vegan. So we don't eat sandwiches a whole lot, but generally straight as opposed to diagonal. Yeah. Again, if you're feeling fancy, then do the diagonal.
What makes the triangle or diagonal fancy?
I don't know.
Rotating the knife 45 degrees.
Yeah. Like, although I do feel like grilled cheese kind of needs to be diagonal.
That's what I was going to add on, because regular sandwiches, or whatever that's, I don't know what a regular sandwich is, I guess. Anything but a grilled cheese, just the regular slice. Yeah. But grilled cheese is always
triangular.
Triangular.
But that's probably because like growing up and going to like Denny's and stuff and getting grilled cheese sandwiches, it was always diagonal. So like in my head, that's the way that it's prepared.
Otherwise,
you expect a Denny's to turn that knife 45 degrees and make it fancy.
Maybe that's why it's fancy. It's because Denny's makes it diagonal, and so that makes it fancy.
And so you're eating out. It's an experience.
Yes.
Exactly. Well, there's more sandwich to, if you're dipping in ketchup or something, ratio. I don't know. There's science to it somewhere.
Or your tomato soup. Or oh, cheese and tomato soup. Oh,
there you go.
That'll be my second.
Next week we'll cover what Gary ate last week after this episode.
Buckle in. It's going to be a long one.
Gary's practicing his Hobbit today.
So Hobbit like, first lunch, yeah. Second lunch, yeah.
Elevensies, yeah.
Oh, elevensies. That's my favorite time of day.
I wonder if you'll be able to hear my stomach growl because it's like on the verge. Like in a minute, it's just going to start doing it. And I wonder if the microphone will pick it up.
I love it. Okay. Now, again, if food is difficult, I know, because the cheese part of this you probably don't partake in, but what utensil do you use to eat mac and cheese or vegan mac and cheese?
Ooh. Fork? Yeah, that's hard. I used to swear by a fork because then you can like just stab it a whole bunch of times and then get like a fork full of
huge mouthful.
Yeah. But functionally a spoon works better.
It's going to depend on the quality again. Like Kraft, it's a fork food. Yeah. but like really like good super creamy, like yeah, you want the spoon in that case because you want to get it all. But Kraft, like,
you could also do fun things with the fork. Like you could stick the noodles on the end of each prong. I used to do that. Yeah.
I didn't think about the playfulness aspect of mac and cheese.
I mean, that's what mac and cheese is for.
No, I know. I should have anticipated that.
Unless you're at like some place that's giving you like a fine dining mac and cheese experience, in which case
it's been like a Le Creuset pot.
Yeah.
So here's the thing that bothers me when you eat mac and cheese out, and maybe I don't know, maybe you all don't run into it, but they do like the truffle mac and cheese. Have you had that? No. It just seems like the flavor doesn't really fit mac and cheese, but it's popular like around here for some reason.
Trying to make something fancy that doesn't need improvement.
No, just make good mac and cheese and be done with it. Right? Yeah. Like it's there in the name. There's not.
Sounds like they can charge more for it if they add some truffle.
I
just think it smells like wrong. Like I don't think it seems appetizing at all. I've certainly had it and I'm just not thrilled with it.
That's disappointing. And I feel like a non-thrilling mac and cheese experience when you order mac and cheese out and it's disappointing. It's just a huge bummer because
And that's
it's just mac and cheese.
That's part of the reason why I don't generally order mac and cheese out, because like if there's mac and cheese on the menu but there's other stuff too, like, well, mac and cheese is mac and cheese, and unless your mac and cheese is freaking phenomenal, the other stuff is something that's not mac and cheese.
There's a great restaurant around here that does has Hamburger Helper on the menu. I mean, this place, like, this is the place I could pull off having Hamburger Helper on the menu because they're open like 22 hours a day and like 200 beers on tap, and they have other really good food. But I mean, if you've been drinking there and you need something to eat that's going to sop up the alcohol, right? When you order Hamburger Helper there, you get like an entire box and a pound of beef. Like the whole thing comes out. So I was talking to the guy that owns the place. Not as exciting, I understand. But the interesting part was, like, there's no distributor that carries it. So he goes out to Walmart and loads up a cart with Hamburger Helper and brings it in and puts it in stock.
Wow.
Because there's no distributor that will supply him with boxes of Hamburger Helper.
And he's dedicated enough to the idea to go do it, too, which is also interesting.
There are a lot of things like that in the menu that he wants, personally, in the menu, so he can get them. So he's more than happy to share. He's a very eccentric guy and just a wonderful asset to the community.
If I were to run a restaurant, though, I would probably do the same thing with the things that I want. So it makes sense. I just wouldn't.
Yeah, but I don't know that I would. I don't know that I would go to the extent of like there's a particular menu ingredient that I can only get at an actual store.
Yeah,
that's the level of extremity that I probably wouldn't go to if I owned a restaurant.
He, yeah, it makes sense when you meet him. I mean, his beer collection. And I say collection because it's beyond like a reasonable amount of beer for anyone human being to own. and it's because he enjoys beer, not like for the drunkenness of it, but like the process of making beer, and it's fascinating. I'm gonna have a beer with lunch. Or breakfast, or whatever it is.
Whatever time.
Brunch.
Oh, amazing. Okay.
Does brunch mean that you have an excuse to eat more? I think that's what you're having.
Yeah, I think so, because it's the combination of the right. two meals. So.
Yeah, it is. It's two meals, so you have to eat more to fill up both of them. That's fair. Yeah, good call.
That's fair. And that reaches the end, because the other only one I have was pineapple on pizza, and then I wrote low-hanging fruit, because I feel like that's...
I don't really have a problem with pineapple on pizza.
I love it.
I also like pineapples, and I know that a lot of people are strongly opposed. In fact, Aaron hates pineapples, and the kids don't eat pineapples, but because I like pineapples, and I guess Aaron's parents do too, but they will get like a pineapple and like put it out, like knowing that I also enjoy pineapple, because no one else does. So like Aaron's always like, you better eat that pineapple.
This is for you.
It ain't for me.
Oh, that's a nice gesture. Yeah. Like a weird thing to connect over.
The weird thing on pineapple on pizza though is how juicy should the pineapple be? I think that's the more interesting question. You know?
Yeah,
if you don't want like a hot big chunk of pineapple, maybe you do, exploding in your mouth. Like, it needs to integrate with the other ingredients. I'm getting
it can't be molten
pizza for lunch.
Yeah. It shouldn't be dried out, because dried out pineapple is just not, I mean, not that it's bad, but it's not as good. It should be bursting in your mouth. Yes.
I think it needs to, like, complement the melty of the cheesiness.
See, I think it should complement the tomato sauce.
Oh.
Which lends itself to smaller pieces of pineapple, so that it's more contained. The outside gets a little leathery, but not chewy. And there's still enough juice in there to.
No.
Well, how would you just describe the outside of like a warmed, like a slightly cooked pineapple?
But it shouldn't. I don't think it should be cooked to that point. It should still be like juicy. It should still be fruit-like.
Yeah. Yeah. It should be like. Just sort of maybe lightly caramelized, but not at the point where it starts getting crispy. Like a little bit of a, I don't know. There's definitely a delicate balance, I think, with pineapple on a pizza.
And that's probably why people don't like it. It's because they've had it poorly prepared. Or they just don't like pineapple, which is also
bad. They don't like pineapple, yeah.
Why did pineapple become the blessed fruit for pizza, I wonder? Like, what other fruits do you put on pizza? I mean, I guess, obviously, tomatoes and peppers. And as we talked at the beginning of the episode, everything's a fruit. But, like, what other fruits? Like, you don't get raisins on pizza.
I've had pear on pizza, like pear and vanilla.
Yeah, okay. that's like a riff on something else. That's like a riff on a salad.
Yeah.
Thank you for listening to Binary Jazz. If you like this episode, you can subscribe to us on iTunes or Google Play. You can visit us online at binaryjazz.us or follow us on Twitter at binaryjazz. Don't forget that you can ask us a question through the form on the website or on Twitter, and we'll read it aloud on the next episode of Binary Jazz.